I found even more helpful Obsidian tweaks and tips for you. And I have a little bonus. Let me show you. In this episode, and I can hardly believe that it is already the fifth one in this series, we will tweak our nodes, callouts, and tables. We are also going to build a neat tasks dashboard and learn how to show a customized help tooltip. Additionally, we will learn how to find the longest nodes in our vault. That's a lot of stuff. So let's begin with formatting our nodes in a special way. Like so many other visual things, the columns layout can be achieved with a CSS snippet. This one I found on the Obsidian Discord server, posted by user Kapirkla, maybe? Kudos to them. If you don't know how to add CSS snippets to Obsidian, check the step-by-step guide to which I left a link in the description for you. Basically, we go to Settings, Appearance, scroll down to CSS Snippets, and click on the folder icon to open the snippets folder. Here, we create a new file, call it columns.css, take the CSS code, which you can find via the link in the description, and just copy it into the new CSS file. We save the file and go back to Obsidian. Here, we click the refresh icon and, once the new snippet shows up, just enable it. Before we see it in action, let's understand what the snippet does. First, we see that it has two sections, one for two columns and one for three. Each of them has its own class called columns2 and columns3, respectively. This is important. We need to use one of these classes on our node to apply the layout we want. Then we can see that we define the number of columns for each class. The rest of the styles are identical right now, but of course you can customize them as you wish. Back in Obsidian, I prepared this node with a lot of text. If we take a look at the node's properties, we will see that there are no CSS classes defined. So let's add the property CSS classes. Next, we give this property the value columns2, and nothing happens. That's because the style will only be applied in reading view. While we are working on the text in preview or source mode, we will still see everything in a single column. So let's switch to reading view, by default with the hotkey Ctrl and E, and right away we will have a two columns layout. Now let's go back to the CSS classes property and change the value from columns2 to columns3. As soon as we do that, and because we're still in reading view, the layout will change accordingly. Obviously, I'm not using this for each and every node, but for some of them, it really is quite handy. Next, I want to share with you how to embed callouts and let your text float around them. I prepared this demo node with some headings, text, and two callouts. By default, the callouts would just sit in their own lines across the whole width of the node. But I often have callouts that do not contain a lot of text, so this wastes quite some space and, in all honesty, it's not very pretty either. So let's fix that. Once again, we add a CSS file to our snippets folder. If you skipped chapter 2, you can go back to see how it is done or use the link in the description to find a detailed guide. We also need to make sure that the new snippet, I called it embedded callouts, is enabled. As before, the CSS has two classes defined. They are called floatR and floatL, for aligning the callouts to the right or left hand side respectively. Each of them has values for the callout size, position, color, border, etc. Contrary to before, we do not apply these classes to the whole node though. Instead, we need to add them to the callouts directly. To do so, we go to the callout and add the pipe character followed by the class name to the callout type. For example, our first callout has the type important and we want it to be floating at the right hand side of my text. So we add pipe float minus r after the important part. And if we switch to reading view, we can see the style for this class and callout applied. Now let's take the second callout and align it left. All we have to do, you guessed it, is to add pipe float minus l to the callout type and go back to reading view. And there you have it, floating callouts that look like you want them to look. And one more tip, if we make the callouts foldable, then we can even minimize them and the text will adapt nicely. This is really helpful. Sometimes I just want to leave short remarks or comments, and instead of using a footnote, I just put them into a nice little callout that people can expand or just fold up again. Do you use a lot of tables in Obsidian and feel that it would be nice to make them look differently? Perhaps even differently from one node to another? Well, user Deacon Light shared some nice table styles over on the Obsidian forum. I find them so helpful that I really want to share them with you. After adding and enabling the CSS snippet, again, see chapter 2 or the guide links in the description, we can pick one of several predefined layouts per node. Let's take a quick look without diving really deep into CSS. Not that I would be qualified to do so anyway. The first part of the CSS defines the styles for what the author calls custom hacks. They allow you to define the table width, alignment, cell sizes, etc. Just take a look and play around with them to find what you like or need. After that, we find the classes for the table layouts. These classes can be combined with the previously mentioned custom hacks. The CSS comes with 6 predefined table styles called purple red, red blue, academia, white red rounded, and yellow cap. I prepared these 6 nodes with a table in each of them. To change the table layout for a node, we once again add the CSS classes property and insert the value of the table layout we want to apply. We will just add 1 class per node to see how the styles differ. Of course, we always have the option to modify these styles directly in the CSS to build the exact layout that we want for our nodes. In this way, we can easily have one for default tables and a very different one for tables with another purpose. It's really entirely up to us. Our next tweak is a combination of CSS and task queries. It is another one that I found on the Obsidian forum, posted there by users ZenRVA. To make it work and look as I show it here, you will need the MCL multi-column CSS and the tasks community plugin. You can find links to both of these things in the description so you can get them easily. And this is what we are going to build: a compact view of tasks that are overdue, due today, due this week, or due after this week. We are also using callouts in a multi-column layout to arrange them nicely. And here is how to build that. For this demo, I created everything in the same node. But of course, your tasks and dashboard can be anywhere across your vault. You just have to adapt the queries accordingly. First, I have these 16 example tasks. As you can see, they all have due dates and some have a priority tag as well. The due dates are evenly split across 4 categories that I mentioned earlier. I also added the to-do tag because in my setup, this is needed to differentiate real tasks that I actually need to do from draft task lists or other list items with checkboxes. Obviously, this might be different for you, and the tag could be omitted or simply changed to whatever it is that you are using. Let's start with the queries. We could, of course, do that with data view, but it's actually much easier to use the tasks queries that come with the tasks plugin. And this is the query for overdue tasks. We first define the path. Unless we want to search the whole vault, then this can be omitted. In my case, I limit the results to tasks in this very node. As I said, this is just a demo and in reality they could be anywhere. Then we only want to see tasks that are not done and were due before today. This query would already give us the correct results, but they are rather long and unwieldy. So we go back to the query and add 3 more lines to hide the edit button, hide the backlink, and use the short mode. Doing that will make the results more compact. Next, we have the query for tasks due today. This looks very similar, but of course, we are now looking for tasks due today rather than before today. And additionally, we want them to be sorted by priority. Leaving the rest of the query unchanged will give us a compact view of the results again. For tasks due this week, we change the due date conditions to after today and this week. So now we have 2 conditions in combination. We also remove the task count and sort the results by due date and priority. And the last query is for tasks that are due after this week and sorts the results by due date, again, removing the task count. Of course, you can adapt all these queries as you wish. As you can see, it's almost like using natural language. And this is what we get. 4 blocks with our example tasks nicely grouped into each of them. But they are not very nicely aligned, are they? To change this, we select each query block, open the command palette by default via Ctrl and P, and search for insert callout. This will turn the whole query block into a callout of the type node. For overdue tasks, I like to change this to important. I will quickly do the same for the other queries. Insert callout, change the callout type. That's a bit better. Now each result has its own callout in the color we want and with a meaningful title. The last step is to arrange these callouts in multiple columns. We can do that back in Source View. We highlight all the callouts together. Once again, open the command palette and hit the Insert Callout command. We then change the callout type to multi-column. Switching back to Read View shows us the result and our callouts are indeed nicely aligned. If this seems like a lot of work, you can simply download the whole block with all these queries from my wiki, the link to which is, of course, once again, in the description. Let's move away from CSS snippets for a moment. The next tweak comes again from the Obsidian forum and was posted by user FierelFlora, which is a pretty cool username. It is based on DataView.js, so we will need the DataView plugin. But don't worry, if you don't know DataView.js, you can simply copy the code from my wiki and paste it. I include detailed inline comments to make adapting it easier for you. As always, the link is in the description. Note that you will need DataView and Better Word Count plugins for this to work. Let's quickly go through the query itself. We start with accessing the Better Word Count API. Next, we fetch all Markdown pages, excluding Excalidraw.md, in our vault. We take this result and store it in an array for creating the table rows. Once we have the array with our pages, we get the word count for each page and add the values as a property to the page object. Then we use the word count to sort the array in descending order and limit the results to the top 10 items. And lastly, we create the results table as an output. And this is how the table looks like. We have a column with the node's name, linking back to the respective node, a column with the word count, and also one with the date when it was last modified. I understand that this is not something everybody or even a lot of people might need, but for those of us who are curious about such things, it is quite nice. The next tweak comes from Reddit, where it was posted by user Content Trouble and takes us back into the realm of CSS and lets us create a nice pop-up or tooltip that appears when we hover over the help icon in the bottom of our left-hand side panel. And this is how it looks like. When we are in Obsidian and hover over the question mark icon down here, we get a nice little tooltip that pops up with any information we want to be there. In my case, it's about callout and task types. First things first. We go back to our snippets folder, you remember, and create a new CSS file. Let's call it helptooltip.css. This is how mine looks. As you can see, it is very long, but most of its content is the encoded version of the pop-up image. Let's remove that part for a moment, and we see that the actual CSS code for creating the tooltip itself is quite short and lets us customize the display options. Depending on the image we choose, we may have to play around a bit to make this look good. This raises the question how we can get any image converted into a string to be used in that CSS file. For that, we need our image in SVG format. You can use online tools or your preferred image editor to get this. Once you have it, you can use an online tool to convert this SVG image into the encoded string. I use CSS Pro for that. For this demo, I just copy my CSS file. After all, I don't want to lose the real one. And take this SVG file. I just drop it onto the website and immediately get the encoded SVG as a CSS URL. We then copy that and paste it into the CSS file and save it. Back in Obsidian, we go to Settings, Appearance, and scroll down to the CSS Snippets area. Here, we deactivate my original Help Tooltip and instead enable the Help Tooltip copy. We close the settings and hover over the Help icon, which brings up the new image. As you can see, it's not perfectly formatted, but this is something to play around with in the CSS file. It's true that this takes a bit of effort to set it up, but if we put relevant content there, then it is well worth the time. For me, it certainly is. By the way, you may have noticed that Obsidian shows my logo whenever I don't have a node open. This works in exactly the same way. It's yet another CSS, I called it emptyNodeLogo.css, and just encoded my logo file as a string. Super simple and nicer than an empty page. And also the logo up here is done in the same way. This is from a tip shared by TFT Hacker. Check the description for the link to that. You are probably aware that the Obsidian Web Clipper received a massive update. It now supports templates, allowing you to customize how web content is captured and formatted when you clip it into your vault. Initially, it comes with a default template, and there are plenty of community-created templates available online too. If you want to know more, check the tutorial I made. The link should be on your screen and is certainly in the description. Following up on this, I also collected a few of my own templates that I find particularly useful for capturing specific types of information from the web. The whole template package can be downloaded for free via the link in the description too. Within the pack, you will find templates for just adding the web page's URL to a list of URLs to check, capturing posts or articles from Twitter, Wikipedia, Reddit, Blue Sky and Medium. I also included two templates for YouTube. One will embed the video, capture its description and transcript into a new node. The other one will just capture the video link and timestamp. Let me know if you need or want any other templates. I will be happy to try and build them. Since I have you here, I would like to take a bit of your time to appreciate the Obsidian community. We have fantastic content creators who build gorgeous themes, helpful plugins, and yes, tutorials for Obsidian. But there are also plenty of quote-unquote normal users who come up with the tips and tweaks that I'm showing in this series of videos. They generously share them on the Obsidian forum, Reddit, and Discord. These contributions make Obsidian such a vibrant and powerful tool. It's really amazing to see. So yes, I do spend hours collecting these tips and transforming them into what I hope to be helpful videos. And I like doing that. However, the real kudos needs to go to the people who created them in the first place. You may have noticed that I mention the source and creator whenever I know them. Possibly these people don't care so much about this, but to me, it just feels right to acknowledge their efforts. While there are too many to list them all, I want to highlight at least some of them by putting links to their respective websites or repositories into the description of this video. I highly recommend checking them out. Oh, and speaking of content creators and other Obsidian related people, if you're using Blue Sky or are going to, then you might find the starter pack helpful that I prepared. I added several accounts there so you can easily follow them and don't have to search for them individually. Obviously, and hopefully, this list will keep growing. If you think somebody is missing, let me know. If you need help or have any questions, the YouTube comments might not be the easiest way to interact with each other. Alternatively, you can find me on your preferred social media platform. You can find the links to all my profiles in the description, of course. And that's it for today. Thanks for watching and see you next time.